All right, let's get started. Now, the second segment will zoom in on arithmetic circuits. This is actually a very important discussion. And even though arithmetic circuits, I introduced these about 20 years ago, the findings and the results we're going to show you next are pretty recent, from about 3 years ago. What happened is this representation got a lot of attention, and people actually started using it in ways different than what was originally intended, which is actually great because it opened up so many possibilities, and I'll tell you about that in a little bit. But two other things happened. This new mode of usage somewhat disconnected ACs from the original semantics, and that actually created issues in terms of missing certain things. And the other thing that happened is there was a change of terminology along the way. So there was some confusion about various things. So we're going to clarify all of this, and you'll see how exciting this whole thing turned out to be. And the way we're going to do this is, if we're going to put this in perspective of what we already done, is if you look at this pipeline, which was the original proposed pipeline, where we go from something like a Bayesian network or more generally a graphical model, write out the Boolean formula, compile a Boolean circuit, get an AC, we're going to cut out the middleman. We're going to now talk directly about the relationship between these circuits and the original guy. In fact, we're going to even abstract one more level up. We're not going to talk about the Bayesian network. We're going to talk about the notion of a factor. Now, remember, a Bayesian network really specifies a distribution. And what I'm really after when I build the circuit is to answer questions about that distribution. The Bayesian network just happens to be a tool for specifying distributions in a compact way. I'm going to get rid of that. And not only talk about distributions, but even a more general version of distributions, which is factors. That is just mappings from instantiations to numbers. And study directly the relationship. The reason this was done, which was 3 years ago, was to remove as much logic from the story as possible, because these developments were actually done by machine learning folks. And we wanted to tell the most abstract story and get to the bottom of what's going on while basically abstracting away details. So why was this mandated? Because one of the developments, and this was in 2008, is a group from UDOP said, you know, why do we actually go from a Bayesian network through this pipeline and do this? Why don't we just learn these guys from data? You saw how cool they are, right? You get to do inference in linear time and so on. So let's learn these directly from data. And even people later start handcrafting these. They're saying, why do I build a Bayesian network or something else? Why don't I just build a circuit? And I handcraft it. And there's more of that happening today. Now, here's what happens when you do that. And this is where people fell in trouble. When you do that, when you're either learning this or handcrafting it, you lost the reference point. What is this trying to do? What is it really computing? What is the reference point? That is not clear. And you start doing manipulations on these guys and doing things and making claims, and there is no even ground truth to check against. So that created issues. So we're going to fix this. And the idea is, even though we're not going to talk about Bayesian networks, we're going to talk about logic, but we have to keep sight of the reference point. The reference point is a factor. Any computation that you're doing has to be with respect to something. If you come and tell me I'm doing something on this guy and I'm getting the right answer, and I'll tell you what is the ground truth for the right answer. For us, we have a factor. And a factor is just a mapping from variable instantiations to numbers. Non-negative numbers. A distribution is a special case of this, but it does not have to be a distribution. And when I have a factor, I can define MPE and MAR. I can say MPE is find me a row with a maximal value, and I want a row that satisfies some event. So B equals false. Among those rows in which B equals false, find me the guy that has the largest value. Okay, what we talked about is a special case of this. Similarly, MAR, sum up the weights of those rows that are compatible with a particular evidence. You see what's going on now? That's an abstraction. If this factor happens to be a distribution that's coming from a Bayesian network, that's a special case, but we're going to do this more generally. Now, we are now ready to go ahead and provide our treatment. And it will be based on two fundamental notions that we have to go over first, And then three fundamental questions that really define this game. They're all pretty simple. Let's get started. First fundamental notion is the AC or arithmetic circuit. So far, we've looked at this as a byproduct of a pipeline, the end result of a whole pipeline that involves many components. Now we're going to start with this as a starting point. So we will define an AC as simply a computation graph that has constants and indicators as inputs, and then multipliers and adders. Now, your variables define these indicators, all right? And then you've got the constants, and then multiply, add. That's basically it. At this point, we're not going to assume anything beyond that. The other fundamental notion is that of evaluating an AC as a particular piece of evidence. What is a piece of evidence? We know that. It's just a variable instantiation. That could be a full variable instantiation or a partial variable instantiation. And the idea here is very simple. You give me a piece of evidence, you say evaluate the circuit at that piece of evidence, then all I do is I go ahead and replace these indicators by zero or one. An indicator is replaced by one if its subscript is consistent with the evidence. Otherwise, it is replaced by zero. Let's take a concrete example. Here are the four indicators I have in this AC. At this particular piece of evidence, if I want to evaluate this AC at this evidence, then I replace these indicators in the following way. Now, why did these two guys get a one? Because they're consistent with the evidence. These two got zeros because they're inconsistent with that. Now, what happens if I want to evaluate on this evidence, which is partial, this is silent on the value of B, then I do this replacement. You can see here both indicators for B got ones because they're both consistent with that and we had the same situation here. Now, all of these concepts are from the original paper on ACs from about 20 years ago, but now we're using this as our starting point. So far, we know nothing except of the AC as a computation graph and this notion of evaluating indicators. The three fundamental questions now are the following. The very first one, and the one that was overlooked, is if you show me an AC, like the one I just gave you, and you start making claims about it, that yes, I can do a linear pass on it to compute this and compute that. Well, before we start any of that game, we have to define what is the factor that is represented by this AC, or what is that factor that this AC is trying to do computations on? And as we mentioned earlier, that's what we're going to call the reference factor. We will also sometimes say, this is the factor that is being computed by the AC. We're going to settle this first. We cannot do any work without settling this first, because that would be the basis for us to evaluate claims. And then once we get through that point, we'll get to the two questions that people are interested in, which is, can I use an AC to compute marginals in linear time, right? That's what makes this a tractable representation. And similarly, can I use the AC to compute the MPE in linear time? We get to these, but only after first settling this particular question. Well, let's get to that question. And it's pretty simple. You give me an AC. From the indicators, I know what are the variables and what are their values, and then I have the structure of my factor. This AC is talking about a factor with two variables, A, B, and here are the values. Each one of them has two values, A, not A, B, not B. Okay, now I need to fill these entries to start with, and this is going to be a simple process where we're just going to go and evaluate the AC at these complete variable instantiations and fill in these numbers. And that would be the factor, all right? That would be our reference point. The important thing here is we are evaluating this AC only over now complete variable instantiations. So let's do that. If we start here, true, you set your indicators as we discussed, you evaluate, you're gonna get the number three. We put that number three here. Then we do it for the second guy, we do it for the third guy, and then the fourth guy. Okay, now we've got our reference point. This is the factor that is computed by this AC, or that is represented by this AC. And now when we start talking about what else can this AC do in linear time, this would be our ground truth. Because if you say this guy computes marginals, then I take whatever marginal it's computing and I can verify them across this guy, right? And similarly for MP and so on. Good. Now, one key observation before we move on. The notion of the factor represented by NAC, as we just defined it here, which is a match over full variable instantiation, nothing else. It is easy to take a Bayesian network and construct NAC that computes the factor of that Bayesian network, as I mentioned. We can do this actually in linear time. Now, this may sound surprising. It shouldn't. Because the relationship between NAC and a factor as we have defined it so far is not interesting from a computational point of view. It's only interesting from a semantic point of view. So the fact that the AC matches the factor over full variable instantiation doesn't mean that we can use it to do things like compute MPE and marginals, and we're going to see this in a little bit. So the bottom line, if you give me a Bayesian network and you say, give me NAC, where the only guarantee on that AC is that it will evaluate correctly over every full variable instantiation, I can do this in linear time. I'm not going to go through the construction. You can see it in the paper, which we will post. And that paper that was published in 2017, it's called On Relaxing Determinism in Arithmetic Circuit. You can check that paper. But it's going to look something like this, where you take the factors of your Bayesian network, add indicators, construct subcircuits, and put these subcircuits together. Okay, you can check it out. Let's go back to our major questions. Now that we have settled the semantics, now we can tackle these guys. And we're going to start with the first one. You give me an AC, and I already know the reference factor for that AC. And then the question is, will that AC compute marginals for that factor in linear time? And will it compute MPE in linear time? Well, how can we check? Very easily. Here's an AC. I went ahead, you just gave me this, and I went ahead and constructed the factor that is represented by that AC or that is computed by that AC, right? That means this AC will generate a 3 if you evaluate it at this full variable instantiation, will generate a 4 at this full variable instantiation, and so on. Now, the question is, does this AC compute marginals? What does that mean? That means if you evaluate it at a partial variable instantiation, not a full one, will it come back with the right answer? Well, let's check for this guy. Here's a partial variable instantiation. I'm saying that the variable A has this value. I'm silent on B. Now, what do I expect the answer to be here? I can now go to ground truth, the factor. If you try to see what is the marginal for this evidence, you should get a 7 because there are two rows that are compatible with this. One has the value 3, the other has the value 4. I add them up, I get a 7. Well, let's see, does this AC do that? Well, let's set the indicators according to this piece of evidence. Look, you know, here, the ones for B are both 1 because this is silent on B. Let me evaluate. What do I get? I get an 8. That's not the answer. This circuit does not compute marginals, right? The question is why? We're going to get to that later. But let me show you an AC for the same factor, but that does actually compute marginals. And it is this one, okay? This is another AC. If you go and see what is the reference point for that AC, what is the factor that it computes, you're going to find that it's exactly the same factor we were just looking at. In fact, let's verify that. So if you evaluate this at AB, then you're going to get 3. If you evaluate it at AB prime, you're going to get a 4. A prime B, you're going to get a 10. A prime B prime, you're going to get a 12, just like the previous guy. But let's see what this does on partial variable instantiation. So here's one that we looked at. At this partial variable instantiation, I should get a 7 as we mentioned. Try this guy, evaluate, you will get a 7. Now, let's try another variable instantiation, B prime, okay? In this case, I should get 4 plus 12, 16. You set the indicators according to this guy. In this case, both indicators for A will get 1. Evaluate, you get a 16. Okay, what happens if I try under the null evidence, right? This guy, no evidence. In this case, I should be adding up all of these numbers because all of these rows are compatible with the null evidence. And indeed, if you go ahead, in this case, we'll have to put all of the indicators as ones. If you do that, you evaluate, you're gonna get a 29. So this AC does compute marginals. The previous one did not, and both of them had the same reference factor. What is going on here? Why did this compute marginals and the other one did not? We're gonna get to this. But let's go to the last fundamental question, which is computing MPE. Now, remember what MPE is on a factor. If you give me a factor and you say, what is the MPE under a particular piece of evidence? I'm looking for those rows that are compatible with the evidence and I'm picking the one that has the highest value. So if we have the null evidence in this case, then I'm trying to look for all of these rows. And in this case, the answer will be 12. This is the row that has the highest value. This is called the MPE value, and this guy is called the MPE instantiation, the instantiation whose value is highest. Now, you could have multiple of these guys, but in 2006, and this was our student, Hei Chan, he said, listen, for ACs, you can use them to compute the MPE as follows. And of course, not any ACs, but we're going to get to that. He said, replace the additions by maximizers. So now you have maxes instead of additions. And evaluate this in the usual way. So you tell me, what is the MPE under a piece of evidence? Replace these indicators according to that piece of evidence and evaluate this guy. And I guarantee you the number you're gonna get here would be the MPE value. So in this particular case, we don't have evidence, we have the null evidence. So these guys end up having the values ones. So if you put these ones here and evaluate, you're gonna get a 12, which is this number. And in fact, the algorithm said more. It said, I can even recover this guy for you by simply starting at the top. And for a max node, always choose its child with the highest value. So that would be this guy here. For a multiplication node, choose all children. So we get back to this point here at this max. Now I'm gonna choose the highest child, which is this guy, and then both children of the multiplication node. So I'm gonna get this. We call this a subcircuit. And the idea is, look at this indicator and at that indicator that appears in the subcircuit. Well, that's precisely the MPE instantiation. Again, this was in 2006. But the point is, in this particular case, this circuit did the MPE computation correctly according to this algorithm. And now I'm going to show you another circuit which cannot do this computation. Here's the one. This is a circuit for this factor. And we know what that means by now. And it was originally, we had pluses here, we replaced them by maxes. And now let's go ahead and see. I want to see if this guy computes the MPE for this guy. No evidence. So I'm going to set these guys to 1, all of them, and evaluate. And now I got 63, not 78, which is the answer. So this guy did not compute the MPE. Okay, so I hope you see now what's going on. And the question is, why did this AC not compute the MPE while the previous one did? What is the story here? Here it is. If an AC computes a factor, that is, represents this particular factor, then it will compute other quantities on that factor, like marginals, MPE, depending on what properties it satisfies, decomposability, determinism, and smoothness. These are the ones we're going to be talking about today, and these are the ones that underlie our Boolean circuits and where the reason behind tractability of these Boolean circuits. Now, even though we defined these properties in the past on Boolean circuits, you can easily define them on arithmetic circuits. And here's a review quickly. When we talked about decomposability, in the Boolean case, we had AND gates. And we said, if you have two subcircuits feeding into an AND gate, the variables of the first subcircuit and the variables of the second subcircuit should not overlap. Same story here, but instead of AND gate, we're talking about the multipliers. You look at the subcircuit, that subcircuit should not overlap in terms of variables. Determinism, this was a property of OR gates in the Boolean case. And the idea, if you had two subcircuits feeding into an OR gate, then under any circuit input or complete variable instantiation, in the logical case was at most one of these will be high. In this case, at most one of these will be none, zero. Okay, smoothness. This was also for OR gates. And we said if you have two subcircuits feeding into an OR gate, then the variables appearing in the subcircuits and the variable appearing in the subcircuit must be the same. Let's take examples, concrete examples of this. And in the examples I'm going to show you next, instead of illustrating these properties, I will illustrate violations of these properties because that's actually a very good way of explaining the properties. So let's start with that. And just before I do that, actually, let me mention the original papers from about 20 years ago used decomposable deterministic smoothness. Later, people started renaming these things. So they called determinism selectivity. They called smoothness completeness. So you're going to find stuff in the literature that talks about selective this and complete that. These are just renamings. We're going to talk about this later. That's part of the reason why the literature got confused due to these renamings, but again, we'll address this later. Now, let's go and illustrate these properties. Decomposability. This AC happens not to be decomposable, and I'm going to show you a violation. Remember what we said. Decomposability refers to multipliers and subcircuits feeding into multipliers. So let's look at this multiplier and look at the two subcircuits feeding into it, one in red and the other in blue. If you look at the variables mentioned in the red subcircuit and the variables mentioned in the blue subcircuit, you find this. Those variables are A and those variables are AB. These guys overlap. That's not supposed to happen. That's a violation. That's not decomposable. For this to be decomposable, this set and that set should be disjoint, and this should be true for every multiplier in the circuit. Okay, good. Let's illustrate determinism. Determinism talks about what happens to the values corresponding to the children of additions under complete instantiations. When I evaluate this guy under complete instantiation, let's look at this complete instantiation. A false, B true. We know what to do for these guys in that case. We go ahead and replace them, and I'm going to evaluate. And then I'm going to show you a violation of determinism. Look what happened here. It's enough to show you one addition node that violated determinism, and it's gonna be this guy here. If you look at its children, this guy had a non-zero value, this guy had a non-zero value. Determinism says, no, at most one child of an addition node can have a non-zero value under any complete instantiation. That is a violation. This is not deterministic. And finally, let's look at smoothness. Similarly, smoothness was with respect to addition nodes. So I can show you a violation of smoothness by pointing to one of them, and we're going to use this guy. Here's the red subcircuit feeding into this. This is the blue subcircuit. If you look at the variables mentioned here and the variables mentioned here, you're going to find A is mentioned here. Nothing is mentioned there. That is a violation. Smoothness says they should be the same. If A is mentioned here, it should be mentioned here. Okay, so I hope this is all clear. Now let's go back and get to the punchline or one of the punchlines of this lecture. Now that we understand these properties of decomposability, smoothness, and determinism on ACs, the basic result that started this whole area was the fact that if an AC computes a factor F, then it will compute marginals NPE in linear time if it is also decomposable, smooth, and deterministic. The original papers from about 20 years ago, okay, this 2003 is the journal paper. These guys appeared like a couple of years before that in conference papers, but this is the most comprehensive paper. I'm going to give you a reference to that later. This was about computing marginals. And in 2006, that was when MPE was shown to be computed in linear time using these maximizer circuits. And interestingly enough, about 10 years after that, a result came out that if an AC is only decomposable and smooth, then you can compute marginals correctly. So you did not need determinism for marginals. And these ACs that are decomposable and smooth, but not deterministic, are known as SPNs or sum product networks. So these came out in 2011. Now, neither this result nor that result appeared in that language in these papers. This is now based on this latest 2017 paper in ICML, which attempted to put some structure on all of these developments after the much confusion and missing things that has been happening since ACs were introduced. Now, SPNs did not just claim that with decomposability and smoothness alone, you can compute marginals. There was also another claim that you can actually compute MPE in linear time using that maximization algorithm that I showed you. And that turns out to be incorrect. And we're going to see now why. So what we're going to be doing next is, now that we understand the parameters of the game, now that we understand the reference factor for an AC, and as a result, we can evaluate claims based on that. And now that we understand what is decomposability, smoothness, and determinism is, what we're going to do is two things. We're going to first look deeper into what are these properties doing? And why is it that if you had smoothness and decomposability, you can compute marginals correctly? And why do you actually need determinism to compute MPE correctly? That was the whole purpose of this study from 3 years ago, because if we had clarity on these things, people would not have fell in trouble like they did. So the next discussion, which will be relatively, hopefully, intuitive and relatively brief, will look into what is really the role of decomposability, smoothness, and determinism. What are they doing? Now, we looked at this before in the Boolean setting. Now we look at this in the arithmetic circuit setting, while bypassing anything we need on logic. This is a story told for non-logicians, in particular, machine learning folks. Let's go. All of these three notions and their roles and what they're doing can be explained using this fundamental notion of a subcircuit due to Hay-Chan in 2006. Appeared many times after that in many new contexts, sometimes looking like as if it is an original discovery. It's not. It is from 2006. Now, what is a subcircuit? You take an AC. You start at the top. For an addition node, you pick precisely one child. You can pick any, precisely one child. For a multiplication node, you pick all children, and you keep going. Exactly one child, all children. By the time you're done, you have a subcircuit. Now, you can understand, depending on what choice I make at addition nodes, I may obtain a different subcircuit. Here's what you need to know. Every subcircuit has two very important attributes. One of them is the term of that subcircuit, which we obtain by looking at the indicators that appear in that subcircuits and collect their subscripts. A prime, B. All right? Now, the other attribute of a subcircuit is its coefficient, where we look at the numbers, the constants that appear in this subcircuit and multiply them. We get a 10. Now you're going to see how the simple notion tells you all of the secrets behind these arithmetic circuits and why they attain the various properties under determinism, decomposability, and smoothness, and so on. But let's take another example of a subcircuit. So in this case, instead of doing this, I'm going to choose this child, all right? So here I chose this, here I chose that. Look what happened. The term changed. Now I have A prime, B prime, and the coefficient changed. Now I have 2 multiplied by 6, 12. Good so far? Okay. Now, the roles of decomposability, smoothness, and determinism can all be explained using this notion of a subcircuit. Look how beautiful it is. First, if you have decomposability, what that means is that guarantees that the term of a subcircuit must be consistent. Remember, the term of a subcircuit was just a number of values for variables. This means you will never have in the term conflicting values. And I'm going to illustrate this in with a concrete example in just a second. What smoothness does is it ensures that the term of every subcircuit mentions all variables. You put these together, then decomposability and smoothness means the term of every subcircuit is a complete variable instantiation. Significant, you'll see why, okay? Let's first illustrate these, and I'm gonna again illustrate them through violations, that if you did not have decomposability, the term of a subcircuit may be inconsistent. If you did not have smoothness, then the term of a subcircuit may not mention all variables. Here's the first counterexample. This AC is not decomposable. Here's a subcircuit. If you go and collect A prime, da da da, B, da da da, A, this is the term, inconsistent. I have A and not A. This will never happen if your circuit was decomposable. Okay, smoothness. This AC is not smooth. Here's the subcircuit, right? And if you look what's going on here, and I come and collect B prime, I go down here, nothing. This is the term, does not mention variable A. That will never happen if the circuit was smooth. The term will end up mentioning A. And we've seen this circuit before and explained why it is actually not smooth. The violation was on this node here. Okay, now let's recap. So what is the role of decomposability and smoothness? Guys, listen to this part. This is fundamental. As I said, when you have both decomposability and smoothness, the term of every subcircuit end up corresponding to a complete variable instantiation. Now, remember, what is a complete variable instantiation? It is a row in this table. In this factor, I have only four different complete variable instantiations. Now, let's look at one subcircuit here. This guy, okay? What is the coefficient? 10, 5, 5 times 2. What is the term? This guy. Okay, we're talking about this. Now, this is the important punchline. It is possible to have another subcircuit with the same term, all right? In this circuit, by the way, in this AC, there's 8 different subcircuits. This is one of them. Now, this one in blue happens to also have this term. So it corresponds to this complete variable instantiation. And its coefficient is 54, all right? So let's verify that. You can go here, this is B prime. You can go here, that's A, B prime, okay? A, B prime. Now let's go to the blue, da, 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 B prime. Go down here, A, B prime. They both correspond to this complete instantiation. They both have different coefficients. Now, these are the only two subcircuits that have this term and that correspond to this row. Look at these numbers, 10, 54, add them up. What do you get? You get 64. So when you have decomposability and smoothness, you can think of these subcircuits as representations of different rows in your factor, except that a particular row may be represented by multiple subcircuits. They all have the same term corresponding to that row, and their coefficients add up to this particular guy. Got it? Okay, now let's take another example, and then we're ready to see what is the role of determinism, and then you got it all. You'll figure out the rest on your own. Okay, here's another example. This is another row, okay? This is the value. And again, it happens to be that there are two subcircuits whose term is this guy. And here they are. Here's the first one in green, right? So this is B prime, A prime, and here's the coefficient. Here's the second one in blue, all right? Again, B prime, A prime, and here's the coefficient. Add up 15 and 63, what do you get? 78, all right? You see what's going on? Okay, now, here's the last insight as far as these properties, which is the role of determinism. We already know what the role of decomposability and smoothness are. Well, guess what? Here's what happens with determinism. decomposability and smoothness said effectively that each subcircuit corresponds to a row in my factor, and it captures part of the value for that row, and that I could have multiple subcircuits for a particular row in the factor. Not anymore when you have determinism. Determinism says there is a one-to-one mapping between subcircuits and complete variable instantiations, that is, rows of your factor. Now, here we're excluding subcircuits that have zero coefficients, and here's an example. Here's a factor we looked at before. And here's a circuit that computes that factor. That is, if you evaluate the circuit at every variable instantiation, you get these numbers. And here are the four subcircuits. There's only four subcircuits in this AC, and they're color-coded. And if you look at the one in red and you look at its coefficient, you get the number three. That's this guy. You look at this guy and you look at its coefficient, it's four that correspond to this row. This guy, its coefficient is 5 times 2, that's 10. That is correspond to this row. And you look at the term BA prime. And that's the last one here, which is the coefficient is 2 times 6, 12. And the instantiation is A prime, B prime, that guy. One-to-one correspondence between the subcircuits and the rows. As I mentioned, you may have subcircuits that have zero coefficients with excluding these. You see what's going on now. Smoothness and decomposability say that the subcircuits correspond to rows, except that for a particular row, I have may have multiple subcircuits. And when I add up their coefficients, I get this. Determinism says, on top of the decomposability and smoothness, says, no, every one of these rows is just one subcircuit. And that ends up being the main reason why the MPE algorithm works, by the way, under determinism. We're going to get to this. And if anyone understood what determinism was doing in the manner we have talked about now, they would have immediately figured out, no, you cannot have the MPE algorithm operating correctly without determinism. But we're going to get to this in a second. So let's get now to just recapping this. Now that you understood what these properties are and what they imply on subcircuits and the relationships between these subcircuits and the rows of a factor, let's just remind you one more thing, because this will seal it. What happens when you set the indicator values to 0 or 1? Really effectively, what you're doing is you're modifying the coefficients of subcircuits. In particular, you are zeroing out coefficients of subcircuits that are not compatible with the evidence. Let's see this. And then once we do this, we go back to these algorithms for computing marginals and MPE, and you see why they work. Here's an AC, and here's the factor it computes. And we're looking at this particular row. And as we mentioned before, there are two subcircuits that are compatible with this row, meaning they have this as their term. And as we mentioned, one of them has this coefficient, the other has this coefficient. You add them up, you get this. Now, what happens when I tell you evaluate the circuit at this variable instantiation? You're going to set these indicators to 0 and 1 like this. Okay? These two guys get 1s because they're compatible, and these guys get 0 because they're not compatible. Look at the circuit now. What did I do really by doing this? I modified the coefficients of subcircuits. In particular, for these two subcircuits in red and blue, which are compatible with this, I actually did not modify their coefficients. Why? Because I just multiplied these coefficients by 1. Look at this guy. That multiplied by 1. Go down here, multiply by 1. Similarly, for this blue guy, I'm multiplying by 1. Those remain. But look at all other subcircuits in this AC. Now, each one of these other circuits, its coefficient is being multiplied by 0. Here's an example. Let's say I'm doing the blue guy, but instead of going down this path, I decided to choose this child instead. I did this. Okay, look what's going on. The coefficient is being multiplied by 0. So you have these rows that are represented by subcircuits whose coefficients add up to this number. And the minute you set your indicators, you went and killed all of the other subcircuits that are not compatible with this. So what is the AC doing when you evaluate it? It is summing up the coefficients of those subcircuits that are compatible with your evidence. And now you can see why the marginals algorithm works under the composability and smoothness. And a similar story for MPE. Now, the MPE story is interesting because remember, what did we say about the MPE? Here's a circuit, AC, computes this factor. It's decomposable, deterministic, and smooth. What does that mean? That means there's a one-to-one correspondence between the subcircuit here without zero coefficients and these rows. Now, same story. When you set your indicators, you are throwing away those subcircuits that are not compatible with your evidence and keeping only these subcircuits that are compatible with the evidence. Now, what are you doing when you're maximizing instead of adding? Instead of summing up the coefficients of these subcircuits that are compatible with your evidence, you are finding the largest coefficient attained by any of these subcircuits. Now, for this algorithm to work, it is necessary that for your MPE solution, that there be a single subcircuit that corresponds to that guy with this value. Otherwise, if you simply go ahead and maximize, you may be picking up a subcircuit whose coefficient is only part of this. The point, any algorithm that claims to solve MPE by returning the coefficient or the highest coefficient attained by a subcircuit, any algorithm that claims to do that without determinism must be wrong, because I may not even have a subcircuit whose coefficient is 12. And I'm only guaranteed that under determinism. So, bottom line, if we understood these properties like we explained here, it would have been immediately obvious that if you drop determinism, you cannot maintain the MPE algorithm. Guys, now you know what's going on. As I mentioned, this MPE algorithm was in 2006. We will post the paper for that. The analysis here is all in this latest paper from 2017, which clarified all of these issues. There was a lot of confusion, a big mess in the literature about all of these things, partly also because of all of the renamings, and some of the papers did not connect to previous works. But let's recap, and I want to mention two more things here before we go to implications. There's more to the story. Here's the first theorem in this paper from 3 years ago, but it's just another proof of the result that appeared in 2011. If an AC computes a factor and it's decomposable and smooth, then the AC computes the marginal, okay? And as we mentioned, ACs that have these two properties only without determinism are known as SPNs, sum product networks. And the other result is for ACs that are deterministic, decomposable, and smooth. And the other result is for ACs that are deterministic, decomposable, and smooth. ACs that satisfy those properties can compute MPE using this algorithm that evaluates the maximizer circuit. Now, ACs as introduced about 20 years ago had these three properties, so they were both good for computing marginals and MPEs. Now, a couple of words on renaming. When the original paper came out, the SPN paper 2011, the story that was told is not what we just talked about, right? So they were kind of presented as an independent concept. They looked like this. And this actually is directly from that paper. So you have adders, multipliers, and you have these probabilities on these edges. You've got your indicators. But actually, the idea here was that instead of taking these guys and adding them up, you take this multiply by this, this multiply by this, this multiply by this, and then you add. So you can unfold this like this. So I'm taking these three guys, and each is being multiplied, and then I'm summing. But that's basically an AC. So if you adjust for notation, this is an AC as we defined it. You're starting with indicators and constants, and then multiplying and adding. Now, as mentioned, the original claim was that SPNs also compute MPE in linear time, which people realized that that's not correct. And then they were like, we want to compute MPE. We need determinism. Let's bring back determinism. So SPNs with determinism. But instead of calling determinism, they called it selectivity. So now there's selective SPNs which are nothing but another name for ACs that are decomposable, deterministic, and smooth. So this is not a new creature. We knew this creature from at least a decade before. So it was just a rename and reclaim of certain results. Now, after people observed that MPE cannot be computed without determinism, there was more work. So they even proven that doing MPE on circuits that are only decomposable and smooth, that's basically NP-complete. This was in a paper in 2016. There was another proof in the paper that we're discussing in this lecture, and you'll see there the citation for this. Now I want to end with two major implications of dropping determinism, because that story turns out to be quite interesting. And I'll briefly mention these. One of them is a kind of a positive implication, and the other is like a negative implication. The positive implication is the following. If you remove determinism and just do smoothness and decomposability, your circuits can be exponentially smaller. That's the bottom line. So there is a factor over n variables where if I want to represent it by a decomposable and smooth AC, I can do this in polysize. So I can give you a polysize circuit that is only decomposable and smooth. But if you insist on determinism, it will blow up. So any AC that computes this factor and is deterministic, decomposable, and smooth will be exponential size. Okay, big deal. So relaxing determinism can allow you to find exponentially smaller circuits that compute marginals. That's a big deal. Now, on the other side, that helps you. That's the gist of what's coming next. This exponential separation helps you when you're perhaps learning or handcrafting these. It doesn't help you as much when you're trying to compile these circuits from models in the following sense. So let's explain it. We're going to call this parametric incompleteness. And to explain this result, I need a couple of slides to explain one concept and one notation, and then we will tell you what this guy is. But again, it is something that effectively says that while compiling models into ACs that are decomposable and deterministic and smooth, we have techniques for that, and we went over that in just the first part of this lecture. Those techniques do not apply if you relax determinism. So the first concept we need is the notion of a set of parameters, which is a set of numbers, whether they are complete for a particular factor. Let me read this and I'll illustrate it with a concrete example. It's pretty simple. We will say that a set of numbers, parameters, is complete for a factor if for every row in that factor, the value attached to that row can be expressed as a product obtained from the numbers in this set. Okay, concrete example. Here's the factor. Three variables ABC, each has two values, eight rows. These are the values of the factors. So these guys are this guy, and this X is ranging over these. Okay, now here's a particular theta, set of parameters. This set is complete for that. What does that mean? I can express each of these numbers by simply a product of numbers from this set. Here it is. Each one of these numbers is just a product of three numbers which come from this set. So this is complete for that. We've seen that notion. The parameters of a Bayesian network are complete for its factors. Remember, here's a Bayesian network. Here are the CPTs. Let me go and collect the distinct numbers that appeared in these CPTs. They happen to be these. Now, the factor for this Bayesian network is this. And as you know, what did we say? We said that each one of these probabilities can be obtained by going to the CPTs and pulling a number from here, a number from here, a number from there, and multiplying them. That's the semantics of Bayesian networks. So you can see why this set of parameters is complete for that. I can express any of these numbers by multiplying a subset of the numbers from the set. Significance, what is the significance? And before I show you the actual result, here's the deal. If you want to compile this model into an arithmetic circuit, then the result I'm going to show you, there's two results. One of them says that if you want this circuit to be decomposable, deterministic, and smooth, all three properties, I guarantee you, you can find such a circuit where the constant in that circuits come from this set. You don't have to look beyond these numbers, which means if you're trying to compute a circuit or compile a circuit for this model, your job is only to really enforce the composability, determinism, and smoothness, because I'm giving you the numbers, I'm giving you the constants. And of course, we have the indicators. So it just becomes a matter of ensuring the composability, determinism, and smoothness. And the bottom line is of what I'm going to show in the next two slides is that is no longer the case if you drop determinism. You cannot restrict yourself to these guys. You may not be able to find a circuit that is only decomposable and smooth if you restrict yourself to these constants, which has major implications on compilability. Let's state these results formally. The next theorem, and all of these results come from this paper from 3 years ago. I'm going to say NAC. I'm going to put these, meaning its indicators are for these variables and its constants come from this set, okay? Now, the theorem says the following. Two theorems. Consider a factor F and let these be complete parameters for that factor. I can express the value of any row by multiplying a bunch of guys from here. You always have an arithmetic circuit that is deterministic, decomposable, and smooth, and whose constants come from this set. In fact, we've seen the proof for this, right? The reductions we've shown in the first segment are just doing that, right? They're a constructive proof of that. And as I said, you know what the implications for that is as far as compiling Bayesian networks. Now, this theorem does not hold if we drop determinism, meaning enforcing decomposability and smoothness is no longer sufficient. Because in that case, you have to search for the AC parameters. You cannot constrain yourself to these only like we did when we were enforcing determinism. The bottom line is reductions like the ones we talked about will not be applicable. Reductions we reduce the task to that of enforcing these decomposability, determinism, and smoothness properties. If you drop determinism, that's not sufficient. Your algorithm, compilation algorithm, has to be searching for parameters. What constants do you use in the AC, which is a completely different story? We don't have algorithms that do that now. So there are complications for compilability when you drop determinism. And in fact, the result was a little bit stronger than this, but I'm going to skip this. It was phrased in particular on Boolean factors. I'm just going to go to the last couple of remarks before we finish here. One remark has to do with the multiplicity of terminology that people have used in the literature and that caused some confusion. It was not just a matter of using different terms. It was in some cases. In other cases, it was not relating proposals to what already exists. Now, you will hear about ACs or arithmetic circuits. You'll hear about SPNs or some product networks. Recently, people are talking about probabilistic circuits. Part of the problem and the confusion that people have, and I get a lot of questions about this. Competent people are struggling to figure out what's going on in the literature. Part of the problem is the following. All of these creatures have been used in a sense, two modes or two senses, in a loose way, to simply mean computation graphs, where the inputs are indicator variables and constants, and then you have adders and multipliers, without any assumptions about properties, just computation graphs. All of these have been used to mean that. But the other usage, and particularly for those guys who are really experts on this, is that those names are attached to particular properties. So sometimes when you say AC, you really mean these computation graphs that happen to be decomposable, deterministic, and smooth. And that's, of course, what we did here. And then SPNs are those that are decomposable and smooth. Now, as we mentioned, selective SPNs are decomposable, deterministic, and smooth. So these are just AC. This is not a new creature. Really, the two interesting creatures are these guys, whether you have the three properties or the two. So once more, sometimes people use these in a loose way, and sometimes they use them in a specific way to refer to this combination of properties. That adds to the confusion. Recently, people start using probabilistic circuits as maybe a remedy, as an umbrella term for all of these things. It's a useful name, but this is restrictive. These circuits are not tied to distributions. As we've seen, they represent factors. Right? And they do computations on factors. These factors do not have to represent probabilistic quantities. They could be energies. They could be anything else. You can think of the ACs as compact representations of exponentially sized factors that allow us to do computations on these factors in time that is linear and the circuit size. So if the circuit size is small, then we're in good shape. But again, they're not really married to probabilistic reasoning. And there's more types of circuits, right? That result from using different properties. We started PSDDs, and those were just nothing but AC. If you unfold notation, there are ACs that satisfy structured decomposability, a stronger version of decomposability, and partition determinism, which is a stronger version of determinism. And now people are mixing other types of properties. The guide I give to people says, look, it doesn't matter what people call things. They can call things anything. They can paint them red, blue. They can draw them this way, that way. What matters is properties. There is no confusion about properties. We know what the properties are, and we know what they do. And these properties all come from the Boolean side. In fact, I don't know of any property in circulation today that was not introduced first on Boolean circuits, and where what we know about it come from the Boolean side. So you want to understand a creature, go and say, what is the properties that it satisfies? Okay. And you may find already another creature with a different name that satisfies those properties. So focus on properties, and that should help you understand what's going on. Forget about whether it's called AC or SPN. Think about it as satisfying decomposability, determinism, and smoothness, and the implications. Decomposability and smoothness only, and the implications. That really gets you to understand what's going on technically while navigating this sea of renamings that is taking place. Let me conclude by a number of milestones in this area, because there's tons of work out there, but there are some really key moments, as they call them, and we'll end with this. Here are the papers, and I think we're going to put pointers to all of these in the description of the video. About 20 years ago, this is the paper that introduced and started this whole area. Again, this was the journal version. The actual papers are a little bit before that. ACs and the properties of decomposability, smoothness, and determinism. This is the paper that introduced the MP algorithm and the notion of subcircuits. This is the paper that effectively started this idea of let's learn ACs from data. Up to this point, it was this is a computational device. I obtained these ACs by compiling models. And here we started going into another world where we learned them from data. It was a big moment, key moment. Some product networks actually made two contributions to this paper. One is they dropped determinism. But again, we'll put a pointer to that paper. The story there is not what was told here. This is a more recent understanding. But the other big idea was that there was also the idea of let's handcraft ACs for certain kind of problems. And of course, in that case, handcraft SPNs. So that was another moment. And the last one is this in 2017, which is basically this lecture, which said, you know, okay, let's take a look at this whole situation and see what's going on here. So it gave a comprehensive theory that explains the role of decomposability, smoothness, and determinism, and put things in perspective. What this paper did is, which is implicit in what we did here, while the original work tied ACs to models and compiling them, and while the other works tied them more to learning and crafting, this paper did not assume any of that, did not assume that you're either compiling these ACs or you're learning them or handcrafting them. The key insight there was, I don't care. I want this notion of a reference factor for the AC, and I'm gonna use it to study everything. And whether that factor is being learned or correspond to a Bayesian network, that's a secondary issue. That was a major insight behind this paper. And that's what we tried to communicate today. All right, guys. That's pretty much what I want to say for today. And I hope this gives you a very good idea of what's going on in this area, which is kind of complementary to what we did in the first segment, where we talked about the compilation of these things. And do check the papers that we will post in the description of this video if you'd like to learn more about these subjects. But otherwise, I will see you in the next lecture. Thank you.